This legislator, Lycurgus, I must needs admire, and hold him to have been one of the wisest of mankind. Certainly, he was no servile imitator of other states. It was by a stroke of invention, rather, and on a pattern much in opposition to the commonly accepted one, that he brought his fatherland to this pinnacle of prosperity. Take, for example, and it is well to begin at the beginning, the whole topic of the begetting and rearing of children. Throughout the rest of the world, the young girl, who will one day become a mother, and I speak of those who may be held to be well brought up, is nurtured on the plainest food attainable, with the scantiest attention of meat or other condiments, whilst, as to wine, they train them either to total abstinence or to take it highly diluted with water. And in imitation, as it were, of the handicraft type, since the majority of artificers are sedentary, we, the rest of the Hellenes, are content that our girls should sit quietly and work wolves. That is all we demand of them. But how are we to expect that women nurtured in this fashion should produce a splendid offspring? Lycurgus pursued a different path. Clothes were things, he held, the furnishing of which might well enough be left to female slaves. And, believing that the highest function of a free woman was the bearing of children, in the first place he insisted on the training of the body as incumbent no less on the female than the male, and in pursuit of the same idea instituted rival contests in running and feats of strength for women as for men. His belief was that where both parents were strong, their progeny would be found to be more vigorous. And so again after marriage. In view of the fact that immoderate intercourse is elsewhere permitted during the earlier period of matrimony, he adopted a principle directly opposite.